Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Sweetwater. And those of you watching at home tonight, welcome as well. My name's Thad Tegmeyer. I'm the retail store manager here at Sweetwater. And tonight, we've got a really special event. Dick Boak and Craig Thatcher are here from Martin. And this is a unique opportunity to hear some amazing artistry from Craig Thatcher, who is a phenomenal player and certainly knows how to treat a Martin well. Dick Boak, who is just a phenomenal historian, he knows the Martin history inside out, and he's got some great stories to share with you as well. So it's going to be a night of entertainment and education, and we're going to be covering the Martin Retro Series, which is a new series for Martin, so it'll be a really unique opportunity for you guys to really check these guitars out and for you to hear them, and as well for those of you at home to hear them as well. So thank you again for coming out. I'd like to bring out now Mr. Craig Thatcher and Dick Boak.
Welcome. Thanks for coming out. Appreciate it. I know it's you're all very busy on a Wednesday night, and we really appreciate it. And also, hello to the web-footed people, the web audience. So my name's Dick Boak. This is my fantastic friend, Craig Thatcher.
Evening, folks.
And we've been working together for a long time. Craig travels all over the world and has played with just about everybody you can imagine. And really honored to have Craig with us. So before we get started, I wanted to tell you a little bit about how I got started at Martin. And hopefully my little clicker will work. Yes? Yes. So that's me, believe it or not. I was what you call one of them there hippies. And I was actually teaching art and woodworking and ceramics in a little private school in New Jersey. And driving from the school back to my hometown, I had to come through the town of Nazareth. And I saw a billboard for Martin guitars. I'd been trying to build guitars in my basement out of balsa wood and cardboard and old oak doors, anything I could find. And I took the tour at Martin, and I was just flabbergasted. I was knocked over by it. I'd never seen the real woods that you use for guitars. And after the tour, I asked the receptionist if there were any scrap woods, and she sent me around to the dumpster there. And I hit the jackpot. It was filled with mahogany and ebony and rosewood and spruce and koa wood and nice pieces. And so I brought my Mustang around, and I filled my car up. And I came back about an hour later, and I filled it up a second time. And over the course of my several years of teaching, I think I came back to that dumpster about 500 times. So much so that the foreman at the back door, his name was Harvey Samuels, he was Pennsylvania Dutch. And he got to know me at the back door, and he called me the kid. And one day I was fully immersed in the dumpster, and Harvey came out and he said, "I saved some stuff for you." And he had a stack of spruce tops that had little knots, things that weren't good enough for Martin guitars, and he handed them to me. I said, "Thanks." And he said, "Well, what do you do with this stuff anyhow?" And I had some jewelry boxes and some instruments. I showed him the jewelry boxes. There's one of them made with Martin scraps, and also a little lathe turning with a pearl band like a D45. And he thought they were pretty neat, and he said, "You got some instruments now." And I handed them up to him, and he said, "Do you mind if I parade them around the shop once?" And I've been practicing this Pennsylvania Dutch thing for a while. So he paraded them around the shop, and he ran into what he called the old man. And it was C.F. Martin III, who at the time was perhaps 85 years old. And Mr. Martin used to walk around the shop. He always held his pants up in the back like this, and he said, "Well, what do you have there, Harvey?" And Harvey said, "Well, look what the kid made." And he looked them over, and he said, "Well, tell that kid to apply for a job." So Harvey brought me the instruments back, and he said, "The old man says you should apply for a job, C-H-O-B, job." So I was fully immersed in sawdust, and I brushed off and combed my hair back a little bit and went around to the receptionist, same receptionist. And I said, "I'd like to apply for a job." And she said, "I don't think we have anything for you." And I said, well, any openings whatsoever? She said, there's only one opening and it's very specific. It's design drafting. I said, well, I've been teaching design drafting for 4 years. I've been doing drafting for 12 years. I'm actually an expert at ink on Mylar drafting and I have examples in the car. Shall I bring them in? She said, really? She's doing her nails. Really looking for somebody that has some experience with woodworking, you know? And I said, well, I've been doing jewelry boxes and lathe turnings with your scraps, and here's some examples. And she said, really looking for somebody that has some experience with musical instruments and guitars. And I said, well, here's two instruments that I made. And the old man said I should apply for a job. So reluctantly, she called human resources up, and they interviewed me. They said, kind of reluctantly, they finally said, could you start tomorrow? And I said, no, I have to go to the Bob Dylan concert. I could start on Wednesday. So that was 38 years ago, and they didn't know that I would have done the job for free. I would have. And it was just a fantastic thing for me to measure up all the parts and draft them and learn the dimensions, because I was intensely interested in that. There's some of my instruments that I handed up to Harvey, made from the Martin scraps. Bokstruments, I called them. And I got right down to work on the draftings. That's an early drafting of the face view of a D28. And I liked how it's very hard to do those curves. I liked how it came out so much that I embellished it into a pointillist ink drawing that Martin has been distributing for the past 30-some years. So that's enough about me. I love my job. And tonight we're going to get into the specifics of the retro series. And the retro series were really a vision of Chris Martin. And that's what we've brought along with us tonight. And Craig's going to sample them. But before we get started too much, I wanted to just talk a little bit about history. And I think many of you know the basic story, but C.F. Martin started in the small town of Markneukirchen in the late 1700s, and his father was a woodworker. And at the age of 15, his father sent him off to Vienna to study in the shop of Johann Stauffer. Stauffer was probably the most famous instrument maker of his day. And he had a shop with perhaps 20 employees and was making fairly plain guitars that sounded pretty good. There's CF. I always considered him kind of a cross between Abraham Lincoln and Don Rickles. So the problem was, and I'm just going to back up here a minute, the problem was that after apprenticing with Stauffer and rising to the level of foreman of the shop, so that he was not only great at building instruments, but he was great at managing the business, he met his wife-to-be, Ottilia, and they got married and had a son, C.F. Martin Jr., and they wanted to move back to Markneukirchen to start up guitar making in the hometown. But when they got back, the violin makers in the town said, you didn't go through an apprenticeship here, and they didn't appreciate guitars very much anyway. They considered them furniture. And they said, you can't practice your trade. So he packed up his family and moved, moved to New York City. 2 months on the water, left in September and arrived in November of 1833. New York City was an awful place with pigs and horses and sheep and ethnic fighting in the streets, and pretty much the same way New York City is today. And they set up shop on Hudson Street, right where the mouth of the Holland Tunnel is now, and had pretty good success. Full-line music store, selling everything, building guitars, but also selling flutes and violins and doing repairs. So does it automatically go back? There we go. After 6 years in New York City, they almost moved back to Markneukirchen, Germany. But instead, they discovered the town of Nazareth. A friend of theirs from Germany had settled in Nazareth, and Nazareth was a German-speaking community, and it reminded them of their hometown. And he was building the very finest instruments in the world. This one is in our museum, and it's made with ivory and lots of pearl embellishment from a small button shop next to his store in New York, called a presentation model. So they moved out to Nazareth and originally settled in Cherry Hill outside of the town, but it became such a problem hooking up the horse and buggy every time they needed to deliver the guitars that they moved into town, built three houses. The house on the left was C.F. Martin Jr., the house on the right was C.F. Martin Sr., and in the middle was their cousin, C.F. Hartman. And they eventually formed a partnership in 1867, which was C.F. Martin and Company. So around 1842, a woman who had emigrated from Spain, probably the finest guitarist in the United States, her name was Madame Degoni, and she was touring all the way from Maine all the way down to Texas doing guitar concerts. And she had heard of the reputation of Martin, and she stopped in and placed an order because she loved the tone of his guitars. And there really weren't many other guitar makers in New York or Nazareth anyway. She ordered a guitar, and Martin made her a instrument that had, for the first time, an X brace pattern. All the guitars up until this point used fan bracing, which had a transverse bar below the sound hole, which really deadened and inhibited the sound. And Martin's X bracing lightened up the top with less wood and distributed all the stress onto the shoulders of the guitar, and also carved away a lot of the excess wood in a process that we call scalloping, which lightened the top and enabled the top to vibrate. Here you can see a top being scalloped. So this pattern kind of caught on, and now it's the most widely copied bracing pattern in the world. And that guitar in 1842 is the very first guitar of any that we've seen made with X bracing. So this is C.F. Martin Jr., who grew into this grizzly bearded fellow. He actually lived into his early 60s, and when he passed away, his son was only 20 years old, his son Frank Henry Martin. This is the earliest known photograph of the shop taken around the turn of the century, and you can see the small 12 fret guitars on the bench. The guitars were called parlor guitars because they were typically played by women to entertain house guests in the parlor of their home. And this is the entire workforce around the turn of the century. Standing in the doorway with the coat and the mustache is Frank Henry Martin, the third generation. And second from the right, the teenager is C.F. Martin III, the one that hired me. And everybody had a specialty. One person would assemble the bodies, one would do the necks, one would do the French polishing, one would do the pearl work, etc. They made about 300 guitars a year with just 9 people. So behind the three houses, they started construction of a building. The building on the right was built first, and then in 1888, the barn on the left was added because of the success of the business. And this is Frank Henry Martin, who we owe a tremendous amount of gratitude for developing most every size and shape of guitar that we know today, including all the guitars that are made by our competitors. So the Hawaiian craze and the ukulele and the slide guitar became a huge fad, as did mandolins in the early part of the 20th century. And here you can see the row of ukuleles. 1925 was the peak of ukuleles, in fact, and they made almost 7 times the number of ukuleles as they did guitars that year. This is Earl Hartzell. And you know, Martin is very much a family business, and his granddaughter now works as one of our neck fitters. So the ukulele craze really put a strain on the factory, and they were forced to expand around 1924 and 1925 with a new wing on the left. And business was great. The road remains unpaved here. And, you know, as we approached World War II, the workforce increased. And actually, these are the smokers. And there you can see a very busy shop on all three floors of the plant. So I got a phone call about 2 years ago from the Nazareth Library saying I really should come down. They had found a box in one of their closets that had a tin with an old film reel in it that said Martin Guitar on it. And I went right down there, and we had no film footage whatsoever of Martin. Certainly not from that far back. So after it was digitized, I did some editing to it, and we have that for you now.
In Odessa in the fall of 64, pawn shop man was leaving, he was locking up the door. I ran up just in time and I hollered through the screen, "Hey man, you got any good guitars in here?" He said, "I got this D18 so I gave him $100 and I took that sucker home. I cleaned it up and strung it, hit a chord and heard that tone. It was crisp and clean, rich and full, all a guitar ought to be. I said, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, you made this D18 for me." I said, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, I'm all right. 'Cause once again, this old guitar helped me through the night. I'm mighty grateful to you, you know how to make them right." I said, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, I'm all right." If I'm feeling down and worthless and I haven't got a dime, wondering if I spent my life just wasting my time, I pick up that old guitar, some paper and a pen. I say, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, you saved my life again. I've written songs about my lovers, my family and my friends, my wife and child, my old home place and the road that never ends. Heroes, hobos, rock and roll, and a honky-tonk queen. I wrote them all without exception on my Martin D18. I said, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, I'm all right. 'Cause once again, this old guitar helped me through the night. I'm mighty grateful to you, you know how to make them right." I said, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, I'm all right." In 43 when I was just a kid, I believe it's about the best thing Mr. Martin ever did. It plays real good, stays in tune, and it never treats me mean. Thank God for Mr. Martin and that fine old D18. Now there's your Gallagher, your Gibson, your Goya, Gretchen, Gill. I played every kind of guitar that them guitar makers built. I picked on a lot of axes, but the best I've ever seen is my funky, beat-up, wonderful old Martin D18. I said, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, I'm all right. 'Cause once again, this old guitar helped me through the night. I'm mighty grateful to you, you know how to make them right." I said, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, I'm all right. I said, "Thank you, Mr. Martin, I'm all right."
It's special to have that. So you see, I don't know if you noticed, they're making D18s, which is significant because we have one of them here. This is C.F. Martin III, around the time that I started working, and that's his grandson, Chris. And Chris's father left the business. He wasn't as suited for the business as the other generations. He left and left C.F. III and Chris to run the business. And actually, C.F. mentored Chris in everything except taste in pants. So this is what our building looks like today. We actually have replicated the North Street plant as the facade of our building, which is our museum and visitor center, and people come from all over the world to take the tour, see the museum, and try out guitars in our pick and parlor. And I know it's a little bit of a drive. It was a little bit of a flight for us this morning at 6 in the morning. But well worth it if you find yourself out in eastern Pennsylvania, about an hour north of Philadelphia, and about an hour and a half west of New York City. So Craig's going to play a little piece for us here. Craig Thatcher?
Yes, I am. How you doing, folks? Everybody good? As Dick mentioned, we have the Retro Series with us. There are four guitars in the series. This is an OM28E Retro. We have a D18, an HD28, and a D45. And we're going to play each one of those tonight, give you examples of how they sound. But there's a lot of electronics inside these guitars, so they're great for the stage and studio. But I just want to play it without the electronics so you get the idea that the guitars have to sound really great acoustically. And then the electronics come after, just to enhance that. It's not like they have to be plugged in. So I'm just playing directly through this microphone right now. I have the volume turned off. Get the idea what the guitar sounds like just acoustically. And now what I'll do is give you a little bit of the electronics. We'll continue with that song. Thank you. example of an OM28. Thank you. OM28s are very balanced from lows to highs. They're very comfortable to play. It's my choice, the OM28 and the triple O, the same body size. So it fits me perfectly, and I get no fatigue from playing this type of guitar. And also these guitars, the OM28 is going to have the long scale, the 25.4, which Dick will probably refer to a little later on.
So we should probably mention that Frank Henry Martin developed about three times the number of shapes that you see up on the screen here. Everything from size 5, size 4, size 3.5, size 3, size 2, size 2.5, size 1, size 0, 00, 000 in 14 and 12 fret models, the F and R and C series archtop guitars, which became the M shape, all of the ukuleles, the O, the tenor, the soprano. All of these shapes and sizes are now the standard of the industry. And really needs to be said that the back and side wood contributes a tremendous amount to the tone of the guitar. Probably the most important part of the guitar is the top. The top wood is either Sitka spruce or Engelmann spruce or Italian Alpine spruce or Adirondack spruce. We've also used Carpathian spruce, really any of the spruces that are old enough in age to produce a tree that you can't touch your hands around when you hug it, will give you a guitar top that needs to be about 9 inches in width, split in half and bookmatched symmetrically to make the top of the guitar. The top of the guitar is like a drum head, it's vibrating, whereas the sides and back of the guitar are absorbing the vibrations and flavoring it. So when the guitars are being made in the shop, it's really interesting to pick them up and tap them because they all have their own character as a drum at that point. So if you look at the different woods for the back and sides, the rosewoods are very prized because they produce a very rich, warm, resonant, deep bass response. Something about the weight of the wood, it's a heavy wood, but also the resin in the wood that produces a warm bass. So we use East Indian and Madagascar rosewood and many other types of rosewood, cocobolo. And in the past, before 1969, we used Brazilian rosewood, but Brazilian rosewood is now heavily restricted. And we can only use wood that we had in 1991 or before, or acquired from a source that was documented to have been in the country before 1991. So it's quite limited, and we don't have very much of it left. Mahogany, conversely, is really the opposite of rosewood. It's very light in weight, and it produces a breathy, clean, glassine, clear treble response. It still has a strong bass, but it's not particularly a thick bass. It's a very powerful bass, but it's a very dry bass. If you're comparing these to wine, the mahogany would be like a Chardonnay, and the rosewood would be like a Cabernet. In between the two is Hawaiian koa, which might be more like a Montepulciano. Hawaiian koa has the not quite the treble response of mahogany and not quite the bass response of rosewood, but nice balance in between the two tones, and it produces a very powerful, pleasant tone. Maple is a pretty popular wood for guitars, and we build some guitars with maple. The complaint about maple is that sometimes it can be harsh, and the credit to maple is that it is a very loud, projective wood for back and sides. And as I mentioned, the various top woods. Necks are typically made of either mahogany or Spanish cedar. Spanish cedar is a little bit lighter weight. It's harder to get than mahogany. The neck contributes something to the tone, And there are really two ways of thinking about tone. One is that a guitar that you pick up that is very light is probably going to sound very good. But a guitar that's heavy is not necessarily going to sound bad at all because, how can I explain this? I have a dining room table in my house, and I have an auto harp. And if I put the auto harp down on the dining room table and strum it, the entire table just vibrates and picks up the vibrations of the auto harp and amplifies them. A heavier rosewood guitar has that type of dining room table effect. Whereas a mahogany guitar is very light. I call them potato chips. They have just a very breathy, light, pleasing tone, and they really vibrate in your hands. So I could talk for several hours about all the tonal characteristics of different woods, but that's a primer. The guitars that we have here, three of them are rosewood and one is mahogany. And the mahogany guitars are typically less expensive than rosewood because the wood doesn't cost quite as much. All of these woods are approaching regulation from endangerment. It's not the guitar making industry that has done this. It's more the wood paneling and plywood and veneer industries, but the wood is quite valuable, and we're willing to pay the price to get the woods that sound the best for guitars. But we're also very, very intent to experiment with the hundreds of other species that kind of fall in their density between rosewood and mahogany, and can create very viable instruments. And we're probably going to need to be using them in the future. Well, this is a fun story, and it doesn't pertain specifically to retro series, but I wanted to tell you about it anyway. I started using Apple computers, and we've got Apple computers all over this store. I've been using them for decades. I started getting emails with people were emailing me this photo. This was an invitation that Apple created for one of Steve Jobs' events, where he was introducing a new iPod called the Apple Insider event. And after I received about 20 or 30 of these emails, people started asking me, is that a Martin? It looks like a Martin guitar. And it certainly did. And I got a couple more emails. There's a better view of it, and you can actually see the three-piece back, which is the Martin D35. And we couldn't figure how they could possibly have taken a guitar and put that sound hole into it. They photoshopped it. They didn't ask our permission, but that was fine with me. We received a couple more photos. There's one of the Apple building with the image projected up onto it. Incredible, and this was pretty exciting for us. I have a friend who works for Apple, and I sent him the images, and he said, "Well, why don't you send an email to Steve Jobs?" I said, "Yeah, right." He said, "sjobs@apple.com." So I composed a little email, and I sent it to Steve, and I couldn't believe that the very next day he answered me back. And he said, "I love Martin guitars, and I own a D28. And do you still make them the way you used to?" And I answered him back and said, "Yes, we do. And I think it would be a great idea if we made a gift for you. This is so cool, this sound hole." So he said, "Yeah, go ahead and make it good." So we started on it. And there's one of the emails that I sent to Steve. And this is the top as we completed the special Apple rosette. It's pretty exciting. And sadly, the guitar was completed on the day that Steve died. And so I made a special label for it and put it inside the guitar, set it next to my desk, and I didn't really know what to do with it. I didn't want to get caught up in the tens of thousands of gifts that were being sent to Apple and probably put in a closet somewhere. So I just set it next to my desk, and I kept it there for the better part of a year when Jimmy Buffett walked through the door wearing his Apple hat. And I said, "You're an Apple fan?" "I'm an Apple fan too." And he said, "Not only am I a fan, I'm best friends with Tim Cook, the head of the company." I said, "Come with me." So upstairs we went, and I unpacked the guitar and I showed him, and he thought it was fantastic. And he said, "You know, I'm going to be doing a benefit concert in San Francisco in 2 weeks, and I've invited Tim Cook to come sit in the front row and see the show. How about if you send me the guitar and I'll present it to him on stage?" And that's what happened. So this guitar now resides in Tim Cook's office at Apple headquarters as a great tribute to Steve Jobs. So, you know, I tell you this because Martin has an incredible and rich history, but the history is continuing with many, many stories like this. So the Retro Series really started as a vision of Chris Martin's. We had the Aura electronic system, which Fishman developed, Fishman, the leader in acoustic sound reinforcement. And Chris's idea was to take instruments from our museum. The museum instruments have had the benefit of aging for many, many, many decades, and they just are magnificent instruments. In fact, the guitars created between 1930 and 1945, kind of called the golden era of Martin guitars, because the materials, the craftsmanship, and the design all came together, thwap, and just created fantastic instruments. We use those instruments in our museum as kind of a benchmark to keep us honest and to try and always emulate the construction, the process, the tone, the level of craftsmanship on those guitars. And so the Retro Series utilized very specific instruments from the museum that were just stellar. And Craig has the OM that he has already played, but he's going to tell you a little bit about this, about the electronics and the microphones and how the Retro Series project evolved.
Well, just to give you a basic overview, anybody know what OM stands for?
Orchestra model.
Came about when a banjo player named Perry Bechtel from Atlanta came.
Well, here I have a picture of him.
There he goes.
And I was actually supposed to show you this picture and tell you the story, and so I forgot.
That's okay.
So can I interject?
You may do it.
And you can jump in too.
All right.
And you can tell me to pipe down if you
go
need
for
to.
It.
So this is Perry Bechtel. He was probably the most famous banjo player in the United States from Atlanta, Georgia. And the banjo started to wane in popularity as the guitar grew and could compete with the banjo. And Perry came to Nazareth and wanted Martin. Martin only made guitars that joined the body at the 12th fret. So a banjo player that was used to playing all the way up to the 20th or 22nd fret was frustrated. He was frustrated. And he asked Martin if Martin could extend or make the neck longer or somehow give him more frets. He wanted 15 frets. Martin laid it out on paper and said, "Well, we can give you 14. So we made a guitar very much like this for Perry, and it kind of revolutionized the guitar industry because it was the first acoustic guitars that were made with 14 frets, and now virtually every guitar you see has 14 frets. So that was in 1930, and you know, thousands of famous musicians use orchestra models because of their versatility, their balance, their clarity. A couple of them here. Perry doesn't want to go away. Well, there's Roy Rogers, and he was one of the very, very first people to embrace the OM, and also Gene Autry owned one. In fact, all of the Cowboys liked them because they were loud and great on stage, and the extra string length made the strings tighter and more projective and pumped more sound into the audience. And there's Paul Simon with Chris Martin and I in New York City. Paul loved the guitar. You know, Paul is only, he's fairly short. He wouldn't like me saying that. But he's fairly short, and the orchestra model really comfortable in his hands. And he just gravitated to this, and he's been playing this for a couple of decades now. Eric Clapton plays a guitar that's exactly this size, but it has a slightly shorter string length. And when you shorten up the string length, you can bend notes more. A shorter string is stretched at less tension, so you could do a full two-note bend, whereas the longer scale is stretched tighter and gives you a little bit more volume. Eric likes it because of its expressiveness for two-note bends. And there's John Mayer, also a huge advocate for the orchestra model, and he has two separate limited editions, one of which is still going and very popular. And a more recent addition to the people that are playing OMs is Marcus Mumford of Mumford & Sons. Immensely popular. It's really important for us to plant seeds with the new generation, and he's a tremendous inspiration. So now, Craig, we're done with the OMs.
It's all good. OM, like I said before, great, great size, really fits well. Very focused, direct sound.
And a slightly wider neck.
Yeah, a little wider neck. And what we have on the Retro Series is we've used a different neck profile than what would have been found on this guitar, say, back in 1930. Back in 1930, the necks were quite large. They're great if you have big hands. A lot of folks can't get around those type of necks too easily. So what we did is come up with this modified low oval. That's the neck shape. It's pretty much, afterwards you can come up and check these out, but it's pretty much the same all the way from the first fret up to where the neck joins the body, the 14th. And the profile, or the taper, is the performing artist taper. So it starts out at 1 3/4, tapers out to 2 1/8 at the 12th fret, and then the string spacing is 2 3/16. Now what we've done...
So actually what that means is instead of being tapered like this, it's more parallel.
More parallel, yes. Which combines for ease of playing. We shot several videos today that I encourage you to go on the Sweetwater site. We went a little bit more in depth on each guitar, each model. You can see and hear a lot of information, and you can certainly call one of your Sweetwater sales engineers to really go over these with you, or you can just check out Martin, the website, and all the information is on the site. So now I already had played it going through the mic for you. So I'm going to do something else. Now most of these things tonight are going to be instrumental, pretty basic, just so you can really hear the tones of the guitar, because it's all about the guitars, right? Rag for you. Thank you. If you're a finger picker, you do any finger style at all, you'll really find these very enjoyable to play.
So, you know, I was walking down the hallway over by the studios here, and I came upon this room that's called the Microphone Vault, and it really struck me because the retro, the way the retro electronics was developed was by taking very, very expensive microphones that nobody could ever afford. Well, some people could. But probably the microphones used to create the sound imaging for these guitars, probably tens of thousands of dollars in microphones. And among them are the Neumann, the RCA, the Altec, the AEA, the Shure, the Sanken, the Scheps, Miltech, AKG, Geffel, Mill Lab, Telefunken, on and on and on. And really some interesting words here. The museum guitar is called the donor guitar. So it was taken down to Nashville into the studio of a Grammy Award-winning studio producer named Bill Vorndick. And he's an expert at recording acoustic instruments. And he has an incredible collection of microphones. And so he recorded the, tell me if I get this right.
You got it right.
He recorded the natural tone, natural acoustic tone of the guitars with a number of different microphones. And then there's a special software that Fishman developed, which is an algorithmic modification software program that interprets and replicates the exact body resonance of that specific guitar. There was a good word here that I really liked that I can't find.
We like to say that Bill did is he created the sonic DNA from the museum pieces and put it into these new guitars. So for instance, for the OM28E, the donor guitar was a 1934 long scale, 00 long scale guitar, essentially the same guitar. For this guitar, which is the D18, Bill used a 1937 D18. For the HD28, he used a 1941 D28. And then for the flagship of the line here, the D45, he used the 1942 D45 from our museum to obtain that sound, what Dick had explained.
And the word that I was looking for is conditioning. Fishman conditions the recordings utilizing their evolved aura imaging technology. So it's a little bit beyond me, but it really works. I think it solves a lot of problems that musicians have on stage. They're describing the tone of the guitar is really in front of you, which is very problematic when you're trying to play on stage with a microphone or with the number of microphones, all those vocal mics and bleed that you get. So this technology practically eliminates feedback
and
delivers a pure acoustic sound on stage or in the studio or in a coffee house or Madison Square Garden, whatever.
And the conditioning that Dick mentioned was, if you look at the tops of these guitars, you'll notice they're a little darker. There's been vintage toner added. Think of the vintage conditioning that Fishman added to the actual undersaddle pickup. As what the toner does to the top, that's what the conditioning does to the pickup. It just gives it that vintage vibe, if you will. And
so
it really works.
We're moving into the Dreadnoughts now. And the Dreadnought is named after a class of English battleships from World War I. Martin started making Dreadnoughts exclusively for the Ditson Company, which was kind of the Sweetwater sound of their day. And between 1916 and 1931, Martin made the Dreadnought for Ditson, but because of the Depression, Ditson went out of business, and Martin took the designs that they had co-developed and started making Dreadnoughts first in 1931 with 12 fret necks, and shortly thereafter with 14 fret necks. And where are we here? So the D18 Retro, you might recognize a couple of these people. There's somebody you might know. Bob Dylan did a lot of recording with his D18. Gordon Lightfoot, all of his six-string work on a D18. The Kingston Trio had many, many different guitars, D18 in their arsenal. Peter, Paul, and Mary, D18s and D28s. There's Paul Simon with a guitar that's much too big for him. And there's Andy Griffith with a very, very famous guitar that he played on the set of the Andy Griffith Show. And we honored Andy with a special limited edition Andy Griffith model, and that was quite a project. I loved working with him, and he always sent me Christmas cards, which was very special. I'd pretend to be Barney.
You do a fine job.
And there's Slash with his D18. It's great to have him playing that. So Craig's going to sample this D18. D18 is a much bigger sound. It's very powerful in comparison to the OMs. Maybe not as balanced, but very clean and clear mahogany, giving that breathy crystalline sound.
So all the Retro Series guitars feature the Aura Plus system. And I'm not going to get into the whole thing about it tonight, but I will show you one feature that I think a lot of us are going to agree on. If you can see that little LED from where you're sitting, that's the tuner. So the tuner's built in. Pretty awesome having that tuner. We can, if you notice here, it muted the signal when I engaged the tuner. And you don't have to be plugged in order to use the tuner, which is really nice too. And as we did with the OM28, I'd like to play this acoustically so you can actually hear those principles here, so we'll... You can hear how each note is very clear. Mahogany is a great wood. Okay. Now I'll put the electronics back on. I do a song I wrote for you. This one is from our latest CD. This came out in May. This is called Before I Go. There's something I just gotta say. I wanna let you know my love for you grows stronger with each passing day. Many people say we wouldn't last. Look at them now, just a memory in our past. Together we showed them just how strong love can be. Little while I'll be on a plane again, flying high across the sea. Yes, it's my job and I love it so, but there's another place I'd rather be. Back in your arms in our little home. It's not a mansion, but it suits us fine. Out in the yard with the kids and the dog, watching the world go by. Before I go, there's something I just gotta say. Wanna let you know my love for you grows stronger with each passing day. Many people said that we would last. Where are they now? Just a memory in our past. I guess we showed them just how strong love can be. While I'm not complaining about what I do, it's the best job in the world for me.
Many people spend their whole lives worrying about the way things turn out to be. But this room gets so lonely, I just want to come home. No place else can do it for me. Remember when I'm gone, my heart's always with you. Close your eyes and think of me before I go. There's something I just gotta say. Wanna let you know my love for you grows stronger with each passing day. Many people said that we wouldn't last. Look at them now, just a memory in our past. I guess we showed them just how strong love can be. All together we showed them just how strong love can be.
Thank you. What a brilliant sounding guitar, isn't it? It's so nice and clear. Wonderful instrument.
Did you write that song about me?
No.
Going there.
So the D28 retro, you know, the D28 guitar is really kind of the workhorse of the whole acoustic guitar industry. And the artist list is pretty amazing. Here's Hank Williams with his D18. And Elvis, King of Rock and Roll, with his D18. He actually has a leather cover on it at this point, which didn't do a tremendous amount for the tone. We call it the tone suppressor. But it actually, it gave a very percussive sound, kind of like that mandolin, kind of choppy sound. Johnny Cash used to get that sound by putting a dollar bill through the strings. So there's Elvis. He owned D28s and D18s. Here's Johnny. This is funny. We got an order. The order came in for a black Martin guitar, and they went up to CF's office and said, we got an order for a black guitar. And he said, we're not making black guitars. We spent a lot of time picking beautiful woods and perfect woods to make the guitars, and we're not painting them black. So they made the guitar behind his back. They kept it a secret from him, and they shipped it down to Nashville. They knew it was for Johnny. Johnny proceeded to appear on the Columbo show with Peter Falk, and CF happened to be watching that night. He was a very kind individual. He loved the fact that it got on TV, so that redeemed the project. And after that, we did many, many different projects with John. And on the right is that photo was taken at Telluride when I presented the first prototype of the Johnny Cash limited edition D42 to John. Somebody you might know. Around the time of Magical Mystery Tour, the Beatles acquired two matching right-handed D28s on Denmark Street in London. And the first thing that Lennon did was take the photograph for the Sgt. Pepper's album cover holding the D28, but that it was an outtake. If you go online and look up all the outtakes, you'll see Lennon with the D28. But they also recorded, on the same day, they recorded the video for Magical Mystery Tour for Hello Goodbye. And John's playing the D28 there. Shortly thereafter, about a week later, they departed for India with George. George was wanting to meditate with the Maharishi. And Ringo was very bored and got a plane ticket and left. John and Paul soon became bored too and wanted to leave but couldn't get a plane flight. They spent an extra week there and wrote 42 songs that became the White Album, Abbey Road, and Let It Be. great songs like Blackbird and Mother Nature's Son and Rocky Raccoon. Here they're working out the lyrics to Obladi Oblada. They drove everybody crazy because they didn't have any verses, only the chorus. And there's Paul now. He's acquired his left-handed. No, actually, that's still the right-handed D28 flipped upside down being played as a lefty. And there he's got the left-handed model. This was at the concert after 9/11. And George Harrison was also a big fan of Martin guitars. This was taken at People's Park in San Francisco, and that's a D18. And there's Jim Croce with his D21, very similar to a D28. Joni Mitchell, almost all of her first four or five albums with Martin Dreadnoughts. Clarence White played a very famous D28, and he died tragically in a senseless car accident. The rumor was that he had put his cigarette butts out on the lip of the sound hole and just dropped them in there. But in fact, we believe that he just was a very hard player and started to chip the wood around the lip of the sound hole. And he took it into a guitar shop and had somebody remove the entire lip of the sound hole up to the first rosette ring, making the sound hole larger. And this, for some reason, had a dramatic effect on the tone of the guitar. And after Clarence died, one of Clarence's biggest fans, Tony Rice, acquired the guitar and has been playing it ever since. And it's a very, very famous guitar. There's Don McLean, who recorded American Pie with his Martin D28. Jimmy Page of Led Zeppelin. All of the acoustic work for Led Zeppelin was done with Jimmy Page's D28. Bruce Springsteen, all of his songwriting and all of his acoustic work for the first four or five albums done on his Martin Dreadnought. Nancy Wilson, who I confess I'm deeply in love with. I'm not sure she shares the feeling. But she sure can kick, and she loves her D28. And there's Sting with his D28. The owners of D28s really read like a who's who. Eric Johnson, a remarkable player. Bob Dylan's son, Jacob, of the Wallflowers. He's actually playing Bob's D28 and has been using it. I think he took it out of the closet without Bob knowing. Dierks Bentley, who's a kind of a contemporary country performer, great player. He's doing the Willie Nelson thing here, is starting to wear a hole through his top. Doesn't seem to have any bad impact on the sound. And Seth Avett of the Avett Brothers playing his D28. So Craig has the HD2080 Retro. Now this is a rosewood guitar, and think of the dining room table and the auto harp, the warmth and greater resonance that the rosewood produces.
So we have a D28 and an HD28. So very quickly, the D28, the difference between the two is the HD is going to have the herringbone binding, and it also has scalloped bracing underneath. So the brace, some of the wood has been removed from the brace, which allows the top to vibrate a little faster. The standard D28 doesn't have that. In the Retro series, at the time these guitars were made, this guitar was taken from, modeled after, I should say, the 1941 D28. They all had this herringbone trim, and they had scalloped bracing, and it was also forward shifted. So all that has been replicated in this particular guitar.
And forward shifted means that the bracing was moved towards the sound hole, which means away from the bridge, allowing the bridge to vibrate a little bit more, which creates a more open, alive sound.
So again, first we're going to go through the microphone. You'll agree it's a great sound, and just the way it is awesome. But when you get on stage and, you know, move around, not have feedback issues, you want to replicate the sound of using one of those $20,000 Neumann microphones on stage.
And $75,000 D28s from 1941. Yeah.
We're at about $100,000 guitar right here.
Yeah, well, give you $100 for it.
So here's another one of my songs. This is from our second CD. It's called Count On Me. Usually I do this with the full band, but we just rearranged it. Every day seems to bring you down. Cry for help, but there's no one around. Your whole body's aching, you don't know where to turn. You can run, but you cannot hide. No escape from the feeling inside. You're being haunted by the bridges you burn. You can count on me. You need a friend. You can count on me. On that you can depend. You can count on me. Whenever life gets you down, you know I'll be around. Things are tough, there ain't no easy way. You made your choices, now you've got to pay. Dealer's collected, he won't leave you alone. Life's a gamble, there ain't no guarantee. You win or lose eventually. That's a hard lesson learned since you've been on your own. Can count on me when you need a friend. You can count on me that you can depend. You can count on me whenever life gets you down. You know I'll be around. To always be so down. Things can't be just as bad as they sound. Even though you feel the weight of the world on your chest. Sometime we all need a helping hand. Some understanding from our fellow man. All you need to do is call on me and I'll do my best. You can count on me when you need a friend. You can count on me on that you can depend.
you can count on me. Whenever life brings you down, you know I'll be around. D28 sound. Thank you. HD28. A lot of overtones.
So the D45, is that where we are? I think it is.
The clicker can't go through your body, Craig. So Gene Autry owned the very first D45. D45 is the top of the line guitar. By the way, these numbers were originally the price. 18 was $18, 28 was $28. That goes back into the 1800s. We have one of the very first style 28 guitars made. And you know, the higher the number, the fancier it was. And inflation changed, but the numbers stuck. And the numbers came to define the styling of those particular levels of ornamentation. So the 45 is the highest level of our stock guitars, and has pearl inlay around the tongue of the fingerboard, around the rosette, around the perimeter of the top, around all the surfaces of the side bindings, around the neck heel, around the perimeter of the back. And although the pearl doesn't add or detract from the sound, it does create an incredible fear in the worker. And that fear becomes something embedded in the guitar that I call caring. And, you know, there was a book called Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance that talked about when you care for something over a long period of time, it becomes part of that object. And I really believe that, because I worked on these myself, and every time a 45 came by, I just was so careful at everything that I did. Now, beyond that, the woods that are selected for this level of guitar, we grade our woods into 8 different categories, plus reject. Anything that has a structural flaw or a serious cosmetic flaw would be rejected and perhaps used for backpackers or something like that, or to make braces. But the D45 gets the highest level, level 8. I can't even say level 8 without getting scared. So, the straightest grain, the most beautiful straight grain spruce. So D45. I should tell you that one of Craig's most favorite guitar players, who might that be that owned a D45, Craig?
Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah. The guitar is on display out in Seattle, Washington, I believe. Well, there's Gene Autry with the very first D45. And in his later years, we honored him with a replica edition of that special instrument that had his name in it. Peter Frampton, after Humble Pie, treated himself to a D45. And about 3 months into his touring, the guitar was stolen from backstage, and he was heartbroken. And I met up with him, and he told me the story, and I said, well, let's rectify that situation. So we did a special Peter Frampton model called the Frampton's Camel. And of course, Crosby, Stills, and Nash, not only all tremendously fervent Martin players, but Stephen Stills in particular is probably largely responsible for the vintage guitar market getting started. Single-handedly, he started collecting Style 45 instruments and bought up about 12 of them and paid top dollar, and it started a trend, a kind of a frenzy for people to try and acquire pre-war Martin guitars. That spread to later models and eventually spread to the electric guitar market. And there's Stephen with one of his T45s, which we replicated in a special Stephen Stills Southern Cross edition. And his bandmate, David Crosby, with his D45. And Neil Young, also on the upper right with his D45, but Neil also owns Hank Williams' D28, and he also owns a D18, and he also owns a D28 that was in an Elliott Ness raid that has bullet holes going right through the side of the guitar. He says he doesn't mind having the extra sound holes. And Craig is going to sample the D45, which is basically the same guitar as the HD28E Retro, the difference being the highest selection of woods and the fear factor.
There's a big sound. Just the microphone again, right? Lovely, lush, full tone. Now we'll go with giving up some of the electronics. Now, just before we get it, before I play this, I want to just tell you there are two sides to the Retro series. There is the Aura Plus, what we call. The Plus came out because some folks found the performing artist guitar with the F1 Aura system in it, with all the bells and whistles, to be a little bit daunting. And I agree, there's a little bit of a learning curve to getting to use it.
Well, there was a master's degree program in how, in, yes. You know, it had so much capability.
It really does.
That you really had to go back to college to learn how to use it.
So Fishman came out with the Aura Plus, and it has the easy mode. And the easy mode is the way it ships. And that means there are three pre-selected blends, plus you have the option to use just the undersaddle pickup. So just to basically give you an idea, there it is with just the pickup, the undersaddle pickup. Here's the first selection. Hear a little more body, that's from the microphone image. Here's the second. A little darker. And the third. So those are your options, the very easy options at a push of a button. Very easy to do. Set it up, and whichever one you like the best, you go for it. You don't have a lot of adjustment over parameters. All we have is what's called a mid-scoop control. Here it is flat. And here it is with the mid scooped out. It's quite noticeable. That's about all you have there. Now, if we reset the guitar, I'm not going to show you how to do that right now, but if we reset the guitar, we can go over to the performing artist mode. Then you have your choice of the 9 different microphone images. You can go in and EQ the undersaddle pickup, the Aura image. You have compression, you have anti-feedback. You have a whole slew of things that, you know, you can really get into and fine-tune the guitar. You don't have to do that. It's there. The capability is there.
So I'm not doing that on this tonight. On my own, on the OM28, I do that. I've gone on and kind of tweaked it a bit. So here's a blues piece for you. Thank you. This is a fun job.
So
chop.
We wondered whether or not you might have questions. We've covered the subject fairly well, and like to open it up if anybody has questions.
Not just about the retros. If you have any, Dick is like an encyclopedia of Martin.
We wanted to get the microphone on the... Oh, here it comes.
What wood is the bracing typically made out of?
What
type of wood is the bracing typically
made of? The bracing is made of quarter sawn spruce. And what that means is that the grain lines stand up as vertical lines as you look at the end of the piece. You think of the grain lines as little I-beams of strength. So the braces are all cut from quarter sawn billets of spruce, same as the guitar top. And that's without exception. I can't think of any exception to the rule. There have been a couple of exceptions over the years. A couple of the Willie Nelson model, the N20, had there was a mahogany brace in there, one mahogany brace for some reason. But nowadays, all the bracing is spruce. Quarter sawn.
And if you had a preference, you could most likely talk with the custom shop.
Oh yeah, we do make some of the guitars are made with Adirondack spruce mm-hmm. braces to go with the Adirondack tops, and the primary wood for the braces is Sitka spruce, which grows between Alaska and Oregon. Other questions?
Well, just about the body stock.
We want to get your question on the record.
The body styles that C.F. Martin had, and there were many of them.
Right.
Did he assemble them and test them out to find tone of which body style was going to work the best or project for him?
Well, C.F. Martin Sr., you're talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay, in the early days, he brought guitar designs from Stauffer from Vienna with him to America and used them until... In the course of about 20 years, requests started coming in from different customers. In particular, Martin had a distributor in New York City named John Cupa, who was Spanish. He was a proponent of Spanish music. The Spanish guitars were different. They were very deep in their body dimension. They had a stripe going around the entire side because the sides were made of two pieces. And had a little piece of inlay between them. They had a foot. Instead of a dovetail joint, they had what's called a Spanish foot. Totally different type of construction. So Martin's was getting
orders from Koopa for these Spanish-style guitars, combining those ideas with what he learned in Vienna, and then adding the X bracing and eliminating the clock key mechanism that he brought from Vienna, making so many slight adjustments to the guitar that it kind of went in a direction that was purely his. With respect to body sizes, he changed the Viennese shape, which was very round and bulbous, into a very beautiful, graceful shape. And he started with one size and simply increased the sizes accordingly. So size 5, 4, 3.5, 3, 2.5, 2, and 1 were all, they all look like the same shape, but they're ever so slightly different sizes. Small guitars have a tremendous treble response, and the bigger you get with the guitar, the more oomph and bass is added. So there's some sweet spots though. The size 2.5 was particularly wonderful, and the women really liked it. It was called a ladies' guitar. And
predominantly women were playing these guitars through the 1800s.
That's well, everybody knows that the women are smarter and more talented than the men. And she did tell me that. Other questions?
What makes the difference on the manufacturing technique pre-war or post-war?
Well, there's a number of different things that changed. One thing that changed is that Martin was making guitars with very thin bracing, and the country and bluegrass musicians were stringing them up with telephone cable, you know, big hunking strings, heavy strings. And the heavy strings were so heavy they were pulling the tops and making the bridges come forward, and it was perceived at Martin to be a problem. There were no such thing as light gauge strings, and so Martin eliminated scallop bracing on the guitars after World War II because of this situation, and the problem still was showing up from time to time, especially on repairs because of the lifetime warranty on Martin guitars for their original owners. And in the 60s, the small bridge support plate that's made of maple that sits underneath the bridge on the inside of the guitar was changed to rosewood and increased in size a little bit. In the early 1970s, testing on glues that was done by Air Products Corporation, which is near Martin, indicated that a newly developed glue that you know as tight bond was significantly stronger than the crystalline animal hide glue made from horses' hides that we were using. The horse hide glue was hard to use. It had to be mixed into a cake and heated in a hot pot, and you had to keep all the parts warm. So the news that there was a glue that was better was perceived as a good thing, and we made a change. What we've realized since is that the hide glue dries to a very hard crystalline structure, whereas the tight bond glue never quite dries all the way, leaving a kind of a layer of thin, almost like latex, a little rubbery layer. So it's a very, very fine point, but the hide glue does make a difference. It's hard to use and it's hard to construct. It takes twice as long, but for people that are extremely discerning, we have guitars that we make with hide glue in what's called the Authentic series. Most of our guitars are still made with the tight bond glue, which is perfectly fine. All of these guitars, and you hear the tone, these are done with the standard tight bond glue.
Also, the bridge was shifted backwards, right?
Well, there's been a lot of I don't want to say anything bad, but I will. People have not always understood what compensation is. Martin guitars, before World War II, it was kind of guesswork. After World War II, the bridge crept forward a little bit, thinking that it should be just double the distance from the nut to the 12th fret, and that's where the saddle went. But in fact, what you need, because of the height of the strings and the tension pushing the string down, which sharpens the note, you need to move the bridge back a very, very specific amount, about between a tenth and an eighth of an inch. And it really needs to be calibrated perfectly, depending on where, if you have high action, it changes the location. You know this from electric guitars, because you have those little saddles that slide back and forth with screws. You can't really do that effectively on an acoustic. So we did a lot of research recently to really hone in on this and correct it, and also add compensation, incremental compensation to the individual string positions on the saddle. So that's another significant change. There are so many more. Yeah. You know, the guitar is a constantly evolving instrument, and we like to make changes that improve the guitar, and we certainly don't like to do anything that impacts it. Anything else?
On your guitars, the nuts and the machines, are they basically the same on all of them?
The tuning machines?
Same.
They're all open vintage style tuners. We have gold hardware on the D45. The other ones are nickel or chrome, right?
Right. These are branded with CF Martin on the back, and they are all the same. They're high ratio, 18-to-1 ratio. Most of the open back gears that were made during the pre-war era were made by Grover. They're called G98s, and they were 14-to-1 ratio. So these are a higher ratio, which means they don't go out of tune easily.
And the nuts are material-wise, basically the same.
The nuts are bone.
Bone.
Made with genuine bone. And I wish I could tell you what animal. I think it's cow bone, and I think it's from India, but I don't think it's Brahma bull. Anybody else?
Yeah. I had a question about the... when you first took the old guitars out of the museum, and then you checked out the sounds and all that, and you tried to replicate the sounds of the old ones, did the electronics change any variance at all to the actual tone of not having the electronics in there? I've always thought...
I mean the presence of the actual package.
Yeah, all the aural sounds you put in there and so forth. I've always had the impression that... excuse me. That when you tinker with that, it somehow violates the natural tone of the guitar. But I know you've really worked on that
well,
and checked it out.
Now, I'm not understanding whether you mean the actual weight of the electronics unit impacting the tone, or whether you mean the fact that you're taking something that's natural and non-electronic and converting it into something that's electronic. And which one do you mean?
No, just the fact that, you know, when you have the wood bracings and all that, you were talking about earlier that, you know, the vibrations off the sides and so forth, and they resonate and vibrate the tops. Does any other foreign objects in there, in my opinion, does that change any of the sounds?
Well, it certainly can. And, you know, electronics from 10 years ago, and actually many companies are still using electronics like this, I call them wall warts. They're big, hunkin', heavy units that where they cut a big window into the side of the guitar. I hated it. I hated to see that happen to a guitar that you spent all this time building. And I wish there were a way to do electronics. As a matter of fact, one of the ideas was to have the electronics just be able to transmit a radio signal through the guitar or somehow off of the guitar, so that you didn't have to do anything on the instrument. But I think what Fishman has done with this particular design is to minimalize the amount of invasion of the guitar and minimize the amount of contact points. There's a tiny little LED light and two knobs, and the two knobs have thin little metal stem coming through the side of the guitar, and I think it's as minimal as it can be. I'm sure it will progress. 50 years from now, I have no idea what it's going to be. You wouldn't believe the evolution of electronics. We have a display in our museum of about 25 different versions that have happened just in the last 15 years.
It's always a trade-off, though. You know, if you're looking for the ease to be able to use it on stage or be in your home recording studio, you're going to give up a little bit in order to use that. So that's the difference. Now, if you're a bluegrass player and you have a 1934 D28, do you want to put that in there? Probably not. You're going to walk up to the microphone and then walk back when you're done your songs. If you're playing in a pop band where you have to cut across a drummer, a bass player, keyboard player, you got to have some kind of electronics or it just doesn't work out. At this point, with this system, I can tell you that no longer do they have to play down to your volume. You can now play up to the volume of the rest of the players on stage with ease. So that's pretty much, you know, where that's coming from.
And of course, the goal is to get it as close as humanly possible to the pure acoustic sound. That's what we're trying to do here. We're not trying to create a phase or chorus effects or whammy bars or echo or anything like that. We're just trying to create pure natural acoustic sound as close as possible through the system. This gentleman, and I use that word very loosely.
Are they working on a mandolin or a higher quality ukulele other than the ukulele, just the soprano size?
Well, we're not making mandolins. And I love mandolins. I have to say that the Gibson mandolin with the little curlicue thing on it, those are have become kind of the standard of the bluegrass world, where the mandolin mostly resides. And the Martin mandolins, which were the A style, they're wonderful little mandolins, but they just didn't sell. And they didn't get embraced by the bluegrass community, which is where we needed them. With respect to ukuleles, we've seen many different surges and declines of the ukulele, and we're currently in the third surge. First one was in 1925, just built up to an incredible peak. And the second one was really what I call Blue Hawaii. Elvis Presley and all the Hawaiian films that followed World War II after Pearl Harbor and the soldiers coming back brought ukuleles with them, and there was a huge surge in ukulele popularity, Arthur Godfrey. And now we're seeing, for the last 10 years, the third major surge. We started with the reintroduction of the soprano ukuleles in the O, which is the simplest version, and now we make a number three ukulele, which is kind of fancy. And we also make the really fancy 5K, which is the kind of the D45 of the ukuleles. We make those in the soprano size, which is the baby size. We're also making the concert ukulele, which is one size up from soprano. And we're also making the tenor ukulele, which is one size, the tenor is one size up, a Martin invention, by the way. The tenor is one size up from the concert, and that's my favorite. I love the tenor size. We're not making the baritone ukuleles. The market for baritone is there, but it's probably less than 100 instruments a year. And it doesn't make sense to spend the $50,000 plus that it takes to tool up to make all the forms and patterns and molds and things that you need to make an instrument. So we're probably not going to do the baritone, but we are making sopranos, concerts, and tenors.
Will those have the electronics in them?
It's possible. We're not offering them with electronics, but it's possible to retrofit. I think any of your luthiers, I think Sweetwater could probably amplify a ukulele. And I've seen it done. We've done it. There's a ukulele player named Kate Micucci, who's been in a number of movies and television shows, and she's playing one that we electrified for on a custom basis. I think if you were irritating enough to us, we would do it.
There's one last thing was you talked about the straightness of the grain. Does that make that much difference?
Well, in the violin world, they have a calculation for the number of times that the sound travels this way before it travels once this way.
Okay.
And it's a very, very specific ratio. And I'm not sure that type of neurosis has been conveyed onto the guitar, but I can tell you that the straight, even grain is the most stable, the most likely to last for a long time, and the stiffness of the top is the most important thing. If the grain tips, if you don't have perfectly vertical grain, the top will be floppy. If you pick the top up, you'd go like this, and it'd go boom, boom. But if you have perfectly vertical grain and do the same thing, it doesn't move at all. It stays perfectly stiff. And I equate that to banjo head. The tighter you tune down on those tension hooks, the tighter the banjo head is stretched, the more of a drum it is. And so the stiffer the top, the more volume and tone and presence you're going to get out of the guitar. You know, I always felt this was voodoo. You know, there's the luthiers will hold the wood and they'll pretend like they actually know what they're doing, and I always called it voodoo. And Lawrence Juber, who was Paul McCartney's guitar player in Wings, asked me whether I would personally select wood for his limited edition from the stack of Adirondack spruce. So I went down and I tried to make some sense out of it. And I had my iPhone with my little tuner on it, and I tapped, and I had the tuner on it, and it was, you know, one top would be like an F sharp, and another one would be a G, and you know, I wrote them down. I tried some Sitka spruce and some Engelmann spruce and some Adirondack spruce and some Italian Alpine spruce, and I was amazed that in rectangular form, all of the different spruces have different tonal ranges. The Adirondack has the highest pitch of all of them. Ping, ping, ping. And the Sitka spruce has a low rumble. Boom, boom, boom. And the Italian Alpine is in the middle. Boom, boom, boom. And the Engelmann spruce. Boom, boom, boom. And the Carpathian spruce, they're all different. And they all make great guitars, but I think the Adirondack is very prized because of the high pitch indicates its degree of stiffness. It adds a complexity to the tone that is subtle, but very recognizable to a trained ear. Anybody else? If not, we'll... Oh, we have one here.
You were talking about the Adirondack spruce. You use it in the D16 and the D28?
One model of the 16 is the D16 Adirondack.
Okay. But you don't use it in like the D18?
Well, it's very hard to get. The reason it's hard to get is because the Adirondack Forest, which occupies about 2/3 of New York State, was converted into a national forest, a national park by Franklin Roosevelt. And it effectively shut the entire logging of any of the woods from that region down. There are a number of towns that are not part of the park. They're actually within the greater area, but there's a number of little pockets where very small number of spruce trees can be harvested. And there's a small section of southern Canada which has either Adirondack spruce or something very close to it. And then there's on the Appalachian Ridge in Tennessee, there's some of the same species of red spruce or Adirondack spruce that can be harvested. So the trees are not as, the wood is not as pretty as Sitka spruce or the other spruces. It tends to be very wide grain comparatively, but we're able to get enough to make limited numbers of guitars in the custom shop, the authentic series, the golden era guitars, and mother? The D16, for example, we grade the wood 45 grade, 41 grade, 28 grade, 18 grade. The 16 grade is the number one and number two grades of that wood. The lower grades in terms of the beauty, but the complexity of tone is still there. So we gathered up a considerable number of level one and two tops, enough to be able to offer it in the 16 series, which I think is a great deal. Does that answer the question? Okay. Thanks so much for coming, and we're going to close with a song by Craig.
Why don't you turn the microphone on, please, and I'm going to play the combination of both, which is really nice. I think I want a D45 now. Thanks a lot, folks.
Thank you. Thank you, Sweetwater, for having us. Thanks for coming.
Mr. Craig Thatcher and Mr. Dick Boak.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. I want to thank Martin for coming out and supporting us, being fantastic partners here at Sweetwater. Thank all of you for coming.